I need a hug first.
It's good to see you.
It's been so long.
I know.
How are you?
I'm good.
Hi, Nancy. It's good to see you today.
It's always good to see you, too.
And so we're going to do your bone marrow aspiration and biopsy to check and see how your bone marrow is doing. This is part of our inherited bone marrow failure syndrome study. Doing the bone marrow today to look for any clonal abnormalities or changes in the chromosomes in your blood cells because of the underlying bone marrow failure that we see with dyskeratosis congenita.
In the clinical genetics branch, we study individuals and families at very high risk of cancer, and several of our studies are taking place at the NIH Clinical Center where we see patients and their families and their family members, whether they're affected or not, for comprehensive evaluations that include things such as bone marrow aspirations, genetic counseling, x-rays, MRIs. They see a multitude of subspecialists because we really want to know within all of the cancer-prone syndromes we study, what's part of having that syndrome versus what's just part of being a member of that family.
With dyskeratosis congenita specifically, we have about 100 families and about 130 or 40 affected individuals. About half of those families have been to the NIH Clinical Center for evaluation. The inherited bone marrow failure syndrome study that Blanche Alter opened in 2001 includes the four major inherited marrow failure syndromes, and dyskeratosis congenita is one of those. And then it also includes Fanconi anemia, Diamond-Blackfan anemia, Shwachman-Diamond syndrome, and some of the other less common syndromes. Dyskeratosis congenita is an inherited bone marrow failure syndrome that's characterized by increased cancer risk, but it can be very challenging to diagnose. Patients with DC have a very wide range of problems that can present at any age and seem to vary within families and between families. There are many genes that, if they're mutated, can cause DC in our patients. And all of those genes are related to telomere biology. And it's telomere biology that we think is causing the problems with DC patients. Patients with DC have extremely short telomeres, and telomeres are the ends of our chromosomes. They are responsible for keeping our chromosomes stable, but they shorten with each cell division. And with successive cell divisions, telomeres get shorter and shorter, and eventually cells are undergo apoptosis or they die. And so telomere length is really sort of a marker of biological aging. Patients with DC have very short telomeres. This was first figured out when the first gene for dyskeratosis congenita was cloned in 1999, and it's called dyskerin or DKC1, and those studies led to the first findings that telomere length was abnormally short in the cell lines from those patients. And then in around 2005 to 2006, Dr. Alter, within our study, evaluated telomere length in blood cells of patients with DC, of their unaffected relatives, and of patients with other inherited bone marrow failure syndromes to see what the differences were. And what we found was that telomere length was extremely sensitive and specific for differentiating patients from DC from their healthy relatives and from patients with inherited marrow failure syndromes. Patients with DC generally have telomere lengths less than the first percentile for age, so that means they're extremely short.
I've heard some people say, like in DC, in a lighter respect, say, right, not the serious aspects of the bone marrow failure, the fibrosis, and everything, but to almost an aging disease because of those shortened telomeres, because the telomeres, they become shorter as you age. They become shorter if you have a lot of stress in your life. But because we start out with them so short, in a way, the fact, I went gray at 13, Charlie had his forelock at 16 or something like that. It almost is, it's the cells that need to regenerate more quickly that are affected or multiply or whatever. Mm-hmm. So it is almost a little bit of an aging disease.
It is. You said that very well. It's actually exactly right in that telomeres are much shorter in people with DC than in people without DC who are at the same age. And it's the cells that divide more frequently, like hair follicles, skin cells, bone marrow cells, other cells like that need to be constantly replenished, that that are at increased risk for having more problems because
right.
their telomeres are starting out much shorter than they should be based on their age.
Right.
And that's exactly why you have this kind of, it's like a premature aging syndrome. She said it way better than I did.
No, I say it. I
see how you say it.
I say it in terms to when I try to explain it to my friends
because
they don't understand it at all.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a very difficult disease to explain.
Yeah.
And because it has such a myriad of symptoms.
Well, and that's what's really hard actually as a physician and as a scientist trying to study DC is that there are such differences in the clinical severity. So there are the patients who have the Hoyer-Riedersen or HH variant of DC who tend to present when they're very, very young as babies or toddlers. They have cerebellar hypoplasia, a small cerebellum, and immunodeficiencies, plus problems associated with DC like the nails and skin changes, the gastrointestinal changes. And they're little children who have a lot of medical problems. Another related variant is Revesz syndrome, which has features of DC, but also has exudative retinopathy or some bleeding in the back of the eye. And then we have patients at the other end of the spectrum who are older adults who have a mutation in a gene that has fewer clinical features or has features that don't develop until they're 40, 50, even 60 years of age. Where, you know, you first symptoms didn't develop until
early 20s.
And then classifying, you know, patients like you who develop symptoms in their 20s versus who develop symptoms in their 40s or even 50s is challenging because it's this broad spectrum. And we know now that a big part of that reason is the genes that are mutated in those patients, the genes that are abnormal in those patients, in that people who tend to have the complications not present themselves until adulthood tend to have mutations in genes that are involved in the telomerase complex and TERT and TERK and some other related genes, whereas the more severe patients with the Hoyer-Riedersen variant or Revesz syndrome tend to have mutations in DKC1, in TIN2, in RTEL1, in TPP1. So understanding the genes that cause DC has really helped us better understand the progression, I think, of the disease and the medical complications we have. When I first started working on DC in 2005, we had three genes that were known to cause DC. And our group has found four new ones. They were now up to 10, and we're still looking. We now know the gene in about 70% of patients, which is great, and it's helping us understand the biology, but you know, we still have to start to apply that understanding to the clinic.
And I just want to interrupt because I you know, some people think, well, what's the big deal of knowing your gene? Mm-hmm. But a lot of people don't really understand or appreciate this, but for somebody, say, like Charlie, who's not horribly sick, and who's young, and who's getting close to maybe getting married if he ever finds a girlfriend, it is crucial to know your gene because mm-hmm. we've reached a point in science and in medicine where he can actually use pre-implantation genetic screening and he can end the disease in his children. Mm-hmm. So they can do IVF and they can look for any of the embryos that carry that gene mutation mm-hmm. and discard them and then only implant the healthy embryos. And it's actually been done in some of the mm-hmm. other, you know, several other DC patients mm-hmm. already successfully. But for me to know that Charlie can have healthy children and not worry, I didn't even know I had this disease when I had my children. So, but he can, you know, not worry about this, and he knows it's going to end in that he's the last one that will carry this in his family. So, having this ability, mm-hmm. but you have to know your gene, and if you don't know your gene, you can't do this. So the work that you're doing, finding these genes, is just, it's just so important and so amazing. Mm-hmm. And I know that there's still families that, you know, are just, I've had them say to me, we're waiting for that phone call.
mm-hmm.
You know, And I'm sure you. Yes. I'm sure you'll be making it someday. So yeah, but it is important. Mm-hmm. I mean, it doesn't sound like it would be, but it's you know, not just for that, but for other reasons. But to me, that's like a really important one.
Mm-hmm. It is, and it's one that patients in our study have used the information that we've gained in this study to then go on and have children who no longer are at risk of this disease because of this.
And we had one that, you know, they lost one child to the disease, and then they wanted to have another child, and they could use your information to have another child.
Yeah.
So it's incredible. Mm-hmm.
So the goals of our study are really multiple. One is to understand the clinical complications in DC, because we're really seeing a much broader spectrum of problems from bone marrow failure, pulmonary fibrosis. We've recently found that pulmonary arteriovenous malformations are present in DC more commonly than maybe we thought, cancer in these patients and other problems. That's one part, the clinical part, which is really important. Another part is the genetic discovery part in characterizing the genes that are causing this disease, which brings me to the third part, which is really in understanding the biology behind dyskeratosis and telomeres and how that gets connected to human disease. By knowing why patients get DC and what effect those specific genetic changes have on the cells and how that affects the telomeres in the cells, which then affects how well the cells can divide and replicate, will really help us understand telomere biology. And telomere biology is very important in cancer because we know that as cells divide, as normal cells divide and telomeres get shorter and shorter, as telomeres get to a critically short length, cells are supposed to either stop dividing, which is called senescence, or die, which is undergoing apoptosis. And so cancer cells continue to divide despite having critically short telomeres because they increase levels of an enzyme called telomerase, which extends telomere lengths. And then that allows cancer cells to continue to divide, which means their chromosomes aren't stable, which means they get more and more changes in the DNA and accumulate more mutations in the cell, which can then propagate more cell divisions and the growth of the cancer. So by stepping back and studying the basic biology of how telomeres work, we can help it'll help us understand how telomeres are important in progression to cancer in the general population as well. And working with families like Nancy's family and all the families in our study is really invaluable because their contributions really make it possible for all of those things I said. So they're generously giving us their time and energy.
We get so much more than you get.
And their blood.
Yeah, you can have all you want.
But we also, the study, when patients, I should say, actually, for all of them, whether or not they come here, we help advise them clinically as much or as little as they want. We send them detailed questionnaires, we review their medical records, and the other thing that they give us is they give us blood to study. From that blood, and we make cell lines, we isolate DNA, and that becomes an extremely valuable resource for the basic scientists who are studying why these specific genes affect telomere biology in the cell. And so I have, numerous collaborators who are not clinicians, who are very basic scientists, who just truly appreciate the fact that we have patients in our study who are allowing us to create these cell lines to that then they can study the function of a specific mutation in a specific gene and how that changes telomere biology in the cell. Because by understanding that, my goal is to really take that back to the clinic and try to fix it.
I've seen lots and lots and lots of doctors, and honestly, even, you know, just, I mean, I had my hips done before I was diagnosed with it, but then I had them revised after I was diagnosed with it. And I went in after the revision and I said, I have this disease. And they said, oh, we've never heard of it. It doesn't matter. I'm like, it's a serious disease, has a lot of hematological issues with it. I said, I'm going to need this many platelets, HLA matched platelets. I said, if I need a transfusion, I'm going to need a leukocyte depleted, you know, red. They're like, you'll be fine. I'm like, no, listen to me. I'm not, you need to listen to me. And you know what? That's Charlie, sorry. But they, you know what, they just, if you're, honestly, when you don't have a doctor, or, you know, a doctor after your name or something, they don't want to listen to you. So honestly, you really need to be as proactive and challenge them. And, you know, and when you have a rare disease like this, it's difficult. And these are top doctors in New York City. So it's nothing like coming here.
Yeah.
I mean, I've had things that my doctors at home have missed totally. I come down here, they fly in, they take care of it. Countless times. So it's, I mean, it's just great being able to come here.
But that's really, I think, the biggest challenge with rare diseases is our patients are more often than not the ones educating their doctors. And that's just not fair for them. And, you know, so that's why we're here for, to help our patients. And I think that goes for everyone in the NIH intramural program is that we study rare diseases and we make advances in them, but we're also here as a resource for people who need to learn more about any of these rare diseases that are being studied here.
And all the doctors in your, in the, well, whatever you call it, the cohort or whatever, all make themselves available. I mean, if I have a question, I feel I can email the doctor and say, what should I do in this situation? Or, and they all say, you know, email me, or, you know, don't feel shy about asking this question.
We and others who work in these fields literally collaborate on writing chapters on every system that might be involved in each of these disorders. And the information in these guidelines book some comes from literature that is written by others and some from the studies we've done here. And the families can take these books to their doctors and work with them.
And our first product was the DC treatment guidelines, which just came out at the end of 2015.
It's always great coming here. The doctors are more knowledgeable than anybody I've encountered anywhere else. You say dyskeratosis congenita to most people and most doctors even, and they have no idea what you're talking about. So just the privilege of coming here is once a year is great.
It's wonderful having the NIH as a resource. And I think other patients do the same, because all of you make yourselves so available, which is unusual for most doctors. And so you guys have your, you know, your arms piled high with all your research and all your clinical visits, but then you're also there to be a resource for us. So I don't know how you juggle it all.
That's what we love doing, though.
But it's, it is really amazing.
Yeah, that's why we're here.
And we appreciate it. And we love you for it. I just, I would reiterate exactly what Charlie said. And, you know, I remember once they had us, they asked us a question about how you feel about being here. And I think, you know, on a basis of 1 to 10 or something, and they asked us individually, and then the whoever it was, they said, I said, a 10, and she said, 10? I said, absolutely. And like, she's like, most people don't say they feel like a 10 coming here. And she said, why would you answer that way? I said, because I feel like coming here, I'm, you know, I get so much information, the doctors are so amazing, and, you know, it gives me, you know, as much to take care of myself as possible, as I can possibly get, and whatever. And then she said, that's so bizarre. That's the exact same answer your son gave.
Oh, really?
And she said, and this he said 10 also, and he said the almost word for word the same thing. And she said, that's just so weird. But, I mean, honestly, we feel this, we feel really, really, really grateful that we're here. And the doctors are just incredible. And they couldn't be kinder and nicer, and so, and we just really feel fortunate, so.